have the pleasure to welcome you tonight to the celebration of a truly great New Yorker and great American, Jim Dumpson. There could be no better place to celebrate this courageous, lifelong advocate for social justice than here in Roosevelt House. This was, as many of you know, Franklin and Eleanor Roosevelt's home from shortly after their marriage until they moved into the White House and began putting the power of government to work, helping the less fortunate. It was during those transformative years that Jim Dumpson launched his career as a social worker. His timing was perfect because this was shortly before the enactment of Social Security, the signature New Deal program that had its birth right here in this home. You see, this beautiful townhouse served as FDR's transition headquarters after his election as president, since the inauguration in those days was not until March. And it was in the upstairs study that he asked Frances Perkins, who had been his Secretary of Labor, to become the first woman cabinet secretary and the first, of course, woman Secretary of Labor in the nation's history. She agreed on one condition, that Roosevelt would support a Social Security safety net for the country that ultimately becomes Social Security. So Jim Dumpson entered government service at a crucial moment in the Roosevelt years, and over the next six decades, he would become one of the most vigorous and effective proponents of the compassionate values that Franklin and Eleanor stood for. We know that Eleanor met Jim Dumpson at least once because she told us about it in her syndicated newspaper column, My Day. It was in February of 1960, only months after Dumpson had been appointed as New York City's welfare commissioner. In her column, Eleanor wrote about attending a luncheon to raise money for UNICEF and described Dumpson's being there. Then, in her characteristically gentle yet insightful style, she added, "I am sure he is trying to do a very good job, but he must have many frustrating experiences in this city." Well, frustrating experience, I think, Mayor, she probably got that one right. But while he may have been frustrated at times, there was no holding Jim Dumpson back. When it came to public service, he was, like Eleanor, a fearless pioneer. The first black welfare commissioner in the nation's history, the first social worker to hold the job in New York City's history, educator, scholar, administrator of hospitals and health service, and above all, constant campaigner for racial and social justice. Perhaps the best single word to describe this towering figure is humanitarian, and humanitarian of unwavering courage. Soon after Mayor Robert Wagner named him welfare commissioner, the Daily News editorial page, which in those days was staunchly conservative, scoffed at his job, saying, quote, "Ladies have babies by assorted gentlemen so as to keep their relief checks growing fatter each year." But Dumpson was not about to be cowed, not even by a newspaper which had then the largest circulation in America. "There's no comfort in living on a subsistence level," he fired back. "No comfort in the necessary intrusions into your private life to find out if you qualify for assistance." And in 1964, when Barry Goldwater, on his way to his party's presidential nomination, called welfare recipients lazy, Jim Dumpson dismissed him as the wealthy cowboy. His courage and determination were enormously important to New York and the nation. During the years of backlash against FDR's New Deal and Lyndon Johnson's war on poverty, Jim Dumpson was a powerful counterforce, an unswerving defender of the simple moral principle that he held most dear. We are all our brother's keepers. One of his proudest memories, in fact, was when a minister told him, "You sound more like a clergyman than I do." All of us at Hunter are extremely proud of our own connections with Jim. He was a professor and associate dean of our School of Social Work during the 60s. That school is now proudly renamed the Silberman School of Social Work in honor of another giant in the field, Buddy Silberman. And I want to welcome Jane Silberman here tonight because I think Buddy would be so proud of honoring Jim and all that he stood for. So for Jane, thank you so much for being here. Some of you may remember that Jim was our commencement speaker in 1992. And in 2005, when he was still an active 96-year-old, I was honored to present him on behalf of our Brookdale Center on Healthy Aging with a New Yorker Forever Award in recognition of his lifetime of extraordinary public service. It was an especially fitting award, for the arc of Jim Dumpson's career spans 60 years, five New York mayors, and a new definition of government's role in helping those in need. So many incredible people in this city, and including so many of them in this room, were influenced by Jim Dumpson's career. It is especially fitting that one of our speakers this evening is one of the mayors he served, David Dinkins. Mr. Mayor, it's always wonderful to have you here at Roosevelt House, and with your permission, I'd like to repeat the quote you gave the New York Times for its obituary on Jim Dumpson, because it was something I think he would have liked. You said, quote, "We look back on it now and say, damn, he was hell of a cat," and indeed he was. Among our other guests this evening, I want to extend a specially warm welcome to Jim Dumpson's widow, Goldie, his daughter, Jeree Wade, who we'll hear from soon, and her husband, Adam. It's wonderful to have so many of the family here. I'm so thrilled that our extraordinary professor, Dr. Mimi Abramovitz, the Bertha Kappan Reynolds Professor of Social Work at Hunter College, is on this panel, as is Pat White, who's now become another colleague at the Silverman School of Social Work. And now, what a pleasure to turn the program over to Alma Carter, who has told the story of this remarkable public servant and his impact on the American welfare system in her wonderfully detailed examination of his collected papers. Dr. Carten, it's really, you've done so much with this program tonight, but with this book that makes such a lasting impression. The Hunter motto is mihi cura futuri, the care of the future is mine, something Dr. Dumpson deeply believed and something that you have done with this book. So it's a pleasure to welcome you tonight to Roosevelt House. Thank you.
Thank you so much, President Robb. And that was really the remarks that you gave. This book was prepared using papers from Dr. Dumpson's collection, which is housed in the archives at Fordham University, where he served as dean. And much of what you said, the book was prepared using excerpts from Dr. Dumpson's papers. And much of you said is housed in those books, and it's really remarkable to hear his story told by you, and that those stories are told in his papers. And one of the reasons I wanted to do that book was to bring to light those papers. And thank you all for being here, because it really promotes Dr. Dumpson's name and all all of the contributions he's made to social welfare. And those papers are there, and I hope it draws attention that people will become interested in taking a look. They're really marvelous. I would get sort of lost in reading those papers. And I should also say that there's a collection in at the Rose Hill campus of Fordham. Jeree also has his private collection of papers, which are just as expansive as his public collection, but they tell such wonderful stories about social welfare and Dr. Dumpson's contributions to social welfare. So what we are going to do today is kind of walk you through, I'm drawing on the papers with our distinguished panel. I don't think our distinguished panel needs an introduction. You see their titles here. But what we're going to do is have a conversation about some of the critical events in Dr. Dumpson's work that sort of reflects the, that's a reflection of social welfare as it developed in New York City and as it developed nationally. So we're going to take a look at, social welfare policy against Dr. Dumpson's career in social welfare, against the backdrop of the Social Security Act. And Dr. Dumpson would be incredibly pleased that this presentation is being given here at this historic site where so much of the work on the Social Security Act was completed. And he would be especially pleased because much of that work was done, as Professor Rabb has said, was by two social workers, Harry Hopkins and Francis Perkins. I want to say that as our profession has gone on, we find that most of us, we sort of introduce ourselves, we define ourselves, we give our titles by our discipline or our specialization. Dr. Dumpson never did that. He always gave his discipline. He always identified himself by his discipline. He was very proud to be a social worker. And when he was taking the oath of office for the commissioner under Mayor Beams, his first commissionership under the Beam administration, he said, I bring to the, and I love his language, so you have to bear with me as I take many excerpts from his book, from his papers, rather. I bring to the position the tenets of my profession of social work. He always referred to himself as a social worker. And when accepting the Humane Letters from Howard University, he said he accepted that degree in 1960. He said, "You not only honor me, but you honor my profession." So although he had many, many titles, commissioner, international consultant, professor, dean of a school of social work, he had many titles, but he always led with his title as social worker. So he also brought to his work always a social work perspective. It was always very clear that whatever he undertook, he was doing it from a social work perspective. And he brought to his work a steadfast commitment to social justice, a steadfast commitment to the plight of dependent children and to other marginalized groups, and the plight of the poor. Those are like standing themes of his work. And he was a strong advocate for the plight of children, and that was part of the reason why, not only children, but that was part of the reason and a named chair in child welfare studies was established for him at Fordham University. And there's a lot of information about the chair in the book. Now, my job is to ask some questions of this distinguished panel, and I promised Mimi I would make my questions short, I wouldn't give away all the information. But since Dr. Dumpson came to New York City from Philadelphia, where he served as a caseworker for the Philadelphia Department of Public Welfare, and it was likely that he took that job because Harry Hopkins has just mandated that a social worker should be involved in every public welfare office that was established after the Social Security Act was passed. But he came to New York City to work on a special program to place African American children in foster family homes. And the thinking was then that African American children could not be placed in foster family homes. So I'm going to begin with Pat, who worked very closely with Dr. Dumpson at the New York Community Trust. And the trust was where he conducted most of his advocacy efforts and most of his advocacy efforts for children. So I'm going to start with you, Pat. Can you walk us through some of the contributions to the field of child welfare that you may have worked with him? Because Pat's former title was Senior Program Officer for Children, Families, and Children, Youth, and Families, a grant program. So you work with Dr. Dumpson a lot on some of his advocacy efforts for children. Can you talk about that? And you're not exclusively about children, because he did some work with the elderly, disaffiliated youth, so his work at the trust as you knew it.
Thank you. I'll gladly do that, but before I do, I'd like to take a commercial moment and thank Dr. Carten for writing the book. It definitely is what I would consider a very high tribute to Dr. Dumpson and his contribution. I also hope that it will become required reading for all social work students. It is just that good. I also want to thank the Roosevelt House and President Rapp for providing this fitting venue for the lecture. I did not want to recognize the many organizations that played a key role in extending invitations to this evening's program to their members, their staff, and to their faculty. And so to all of you, thank you. It's interesting in talking about Dr. Dumpson. Dr. Dumpson spent what one would consider to be the last quarter century of his career in philanthropy. He was well over the age of 65 when he began at the trust in 1975. He served in the capacity of vice president and then as a senior consultant until 2005. You will hear during the course of the evening about Dr. Dumpson's contribution in the public sector and in academia. But I would venture to say that his entry into philanthropy represented a new frontier. It's when you have accomplished all that you can in the many other spheres, what's left? And philanthropy represented one of those territories for him. It was one of the places where he also had a chance to prove something that he would that he was famous for noting, and that is that age is just a number. Remember, he came well into his 60s and brought so much energy and vitality to the work. There are probably three areas that represent some of the significant work for Dr. Dumpson. I'm going to talk initially about two of them, and hopefully we'll come back to the third later. The first was, as he did his work in the public sector related to children and families, philanthropy represented a space where he could make the, what I often call the interconnection of philanthropy and the public sector in terms of how those two systems or entities might work together on behalf of children and families. So he brought that emphasis on the work in philanthropy. He also, during the course of his time there, lifted up the needs of new and emerging groups and issues. And doing this all while he maintained his focus and passion around the needs of children and families. In the first instance, in terms of the interdependency of philanthropy and the public sector, Dr. Dumpson was often the constant voice and presence in rooms with donors who were interested in issues affecting children and families and the role of social workers. I could almost imagine conversations between Jane's dad, Buddy Silverman, and Dr. Dumpson around the role of the social work profession and the needs of children and families. And of course, those kinds of conversations led to the commitment of Mr. Silverman to social work education and to what is so much a valued institution here in the city, the first public school of social work. Dr. Dumpson was also the go-to person for anything that had to do with government and government at all levels. His name, the mere mention of his name opened governmental doors, whether it was at ACS, HRA, and I realize that I'm now getting into the alphabet soup. And for some of you, you understand what those are, but it's the Agency for Child Development, Human Resources Administration, and even the Department for Homeless Services. All agencies that were for him critical to the well-being of children and families. And in fact, Dr. Dumpson and I often worked together to look at ways in which we could elevate the work of those two institutions, the public sector and philanthropy, in this space to improve conditions for children and families. In the second instance, in terms of addressing new issues, many of you might remember that while the issue of AIDS was known as a gay issue, it was folks like Dr. Dumpson and others who helped to bring to light the devastating impact that AIDS was having in the Black community and advocating for dollars and for policies that spoke to the impact of this issue in Black communities and for children and their families. He was also the first chair of the Black Commission on AIDS. Many of you might remember that. and one of the other signature bodies of work for Dr. Dumpson in philanthropy, was in the area of aging. He and Rose Dobroff, who many of you probably know, passed recently, were two of the folks who really shepherded the work around the creation of a center on aging for the purpose of contributing to research, practice, and policy development as it pertains to the needs and challenges of the elderly. As I said, Dr. Dumpson did all of this work, and at no time did his focus on children and families take second stage to his work. And in fact, I would often say, as the young program officer that I was during that time, the man has more energy than many of us together. And clearly, he brought that energy and his strategic thinking to everything that he did. Those were some of the issues that Dr. Dumpson cared about and the many ways in which he was involved. But I would be remiss if I didn't note that at the same time, he continued to have an active role as an advisor on several boards of nonprofit organizations throughout the city. And some of them are represented here tonight, like the United Way of New York City, the Federation of Protestant Welfare Agency, Black Agency Executive, Citizens Committee for Children, Community Service Society, and of course, the National Association of Social Workers, just to cite a few. But even well into his senior years, the field of philanthropy offered an opportunity for Dr. Dumpson to continue to press for a better and what he would often call a caring society. And what better population do we begin to focus that work on than the children of our city?
Thanks, Pat. Pat, in giving that very, you really overviewed many of the areas that Dr. Dumpson worked in, and his work spanned, when we think about his work in government service, we think about his work in academia, and we think about his work in philanthropy, they were all sort of integrated. And his work for children, his contributions to policy development for children was clearly reflected in his work as Commissioner of Social Welfare. And when we see him in his position as Commissioner of Welfare, we see that highly controversial program that was much of the work, the Aid to Dependent Children's Program, as it was originally started, told a lot of controversy. And this is what I love about what Dr. Dumpson said. He was always a very strong advocate, and then I want Mimi to talk more about that because this has been an area of her specialization. He said in the 1950s, when there was an awful lot of comment, you are here too young to remember that, but in the 1950s, there was a lot of controversy about the AFDC program, and this is what he said: that much maligned program is and always has been a children's program and not a haven for beer-drinking, promiscuous, able-bodied males, as some would have us to believe. Much of Mimi's work has been directed towards welfare reform and the plight of women. Has been the focus of her scholarship on welfare reform and the plight of women. So, Mimi, can you walk us through some of the, elaborate on some of the changes that occurred in this climate, this political climate, as it sort of transitioned from being sometimes very generous and sometimes being very repressive and very punitive?
Thank you. I'm a history buff, so I'll be happy to do that. But first, I too want to thank President Rabb, the leadership of Roosevelt House, where I am a Roosevelt House associate, I'm proud to say. And I'd also like to welcome the dean of my school, Mary Cavanaugh, sitting way there in the back, and some faculty from the Silverman School of Social Work, among others. So thank you all for coming to this event. It's really appreciated. Also, I guess I'm the one person on the panel who didn't know Dr. Dumpson personally. Both Mayor Dinkins and Pat White worked with him very closely over the years. So I have I heard of him, but I wasn't even in New York during most of the time where he was serving. I was living in New Haven, Connecticut, some of that time, a little later, not in 1930. So I got most of what I learned was from Alma's book, and I have to say that I love this book. I really, the way she wove historical review into the life of Jim Dumpson was quite amazing. And I said I'm a history buff, and she reminded me of so much of that history about social welfare that I often wrote about and taught about, but hadn't thought about recently. So it was a really good refresher course, and I agree, it would be great to have this in schools of social work. Yes, we have to find more time for history in our classes. So my major takeaway from this book was that Dumpson put his money where his mouth is. He served the city whenever he was called, and he was called many times. And he stuck to his principles wherever he worked, in public service, the academy, and philanthropy. He fought the good fight in every role, which meant through thick and thin, when the tide was with him and when it wasn't. It took wisdom, skill, courage, and principle. But his principles were truly tested as he served during two periods, which I'd like to emphasize, because I find it interesting for a social worker to have to work under this particular kind of period, in which public policy was not on his side. This was the mid-50s and the mid-70s. In between, he had greater opportunity to try to carry out some of his progressive or social justice agenda. So one way I think about framing his career is that it reflects the twin pressures of containment and change that have plagued social work and social welfare policy from its origins in the late 19th century. The profession can boast of a long history of progressive activism directed to individual and social change, and he was definitely part of that. At the same time, some observers have accused us of serving as a handmaiden of the status quo. Dumpson did not escape that dilemma. However, it's important to realize as we talk about this, that this dual function that is built into our work has made the social work profession and the welfare state a site of ongoing struggle. And that struggle is the foundation of the social change that Dumpson was always working for. So if you have a few more minutes, I'll say just a little bit more. So I think of him as a New Dealer to the very end of his career. As been mentioned, he begins his social work career in the late 50s, as a caseworker as a caseworker in the Philadelphia Department of Public Welfare. And this resonated with me because I began my social work career as a caseworker in the State Welfare Department in Connecticut, located in New Haven. It was many years later. but I know that job well. And after that's when I went to school, and that's what he did. He took that job, and then he went to school. And he started working, as has been mentioned already, after the enactment of the 1935 Social Security Act. And then he moved a lot around. It was really hard to keep up with him, and he moved around.
He moved around, if I can just interject, and we talked about that. He moved with a lot of ease between those three areas in which he worked. He really did not see a separation between what he was doing in academia, what he was doing as a government service, and what he was doing in philanthropy. There was this kind of easing. He didn't separate.
Well, he fought that good fight wherever he was, and it was really impressive. But in his earlier years, he moved between social work and graduate school. Those are some of the earliest moves. And during the late 50s, he started to move up the ranks of government service until Mayor Wagner appointed him as the commissioner of welfare in New York City in 1959, where he served until 1965. And here's where you see some of the dilemmas. That was the first period where you see some of the dilemmas, because it was the best of times and it was the worst of times for public welfare. On the one hand, the 1954 Supreme Court rendered separate but equal public schools to be unconstitutional. And in 55, the AFL-CIO merged, reached its peak membership in 1955, about 35% of the workforce. Johnson launched the war on poverty in the early 60s. So throughout this decades, under pressure from the social movements And due to changing social, economic, and political conditions, the social welfare system that many of us in this room have been part of for many years continued to expand. It covered more people, it met more needs, and lo and behold, poverty and inequality lost ground. We made progress on those fronts. Some call this the golden age of capitalism because the standard of living for almost everybody, with some exceptions and not the same for everybody, rose. At the same time, right, we had the Cold War, anti-communism, and the Dixiecrats controlled Congress. Today, we have the Tea Party. Then as now, those hostile to public welfare took aim at the program for single mothers called age-dependent children. The caseloads were growing, the costs were rising, and there was overrepresentation of women of color on this program. So it made ADC a perfect target for those who would shrink, if not eliminate, the entire welfare system. States across the country adopted restrictive and punitive policies, not unlike today. Some of you might remember Newburgh, New York. Anyone remember Newburgh, New York here? Anybody? It was in the early 60s. It was a scandalous, racialized attack on women of color, and they just threw everybody off welfare because they had children outside of marriage, among other things. So in 1959, Dumpson was appointed to be the Commissioner of Welfare. As Jennifer mentioned, he was the first black welfare commissioner and the first social worker to serve oversee welfare in the United States. Sadly, and here comes the other side of the story, his task was to reduce the city's welfare rolls. That's what he was asked to do. Now, I'm not sure exactly what he did to carry this out programmatically, but even as he presided over welfare cuts, he openly critiqued, which was rather brave, the policy. He used his position to remind the public that active government and robust social welfare programs for those in need were the best way to improve the well-being of everyone. He fiercely defended relief payments as both necessary and moral. I have a lot more to say, but maybe should I go on or should I?
Would you like a minute or so.
A minute, okay, well.
We're going to come back to you anyway.
Okay, so let me just say, then he was, for a while, we had a more liberal climate. And he was commissioner then, too. He witnessed the election of JFK, the enactment of the 1962 amendments to the Social Security Act, which provided services and financial support, which was a new thing then, and for single mothers on welfare, and funds to train social workers. Many social workers got scholarships to go to social work school because of that. He also created this public child welfare agency for the placement of black children, as you mentioned. This more liberal political climate was compatible with Dumpson's personal views. But there was no rest for the weary during this time, these turbulent times. So what happened in 65, the United States entered the war in Vietnam, and Dumpson presided over the first strike ever. Does anyone remember the first strike ever of public assistance workers? Seeking higher salaries, a union contract, and better services for their clients. The strike lasted for 25 days. They sat in, they shut down the welfare office. It was also the heyday of the welfare rights movement. Women on welfare occupied the welfare offices. They wanted more benefits and more responsive services. And during this infamous 60s period, Dumpson had to implement policies in relation to the strikers and welfare mothers that he later acknowledged he really didn't agree with, did not fully agree with. That could not have been very easy. So he resigned from this office in 1965, just after the War on Poverty was launched. But he continued advocating for progressive reforms in other venues. And I'll skip over some of that to just take you into the 70s, the mid-70s, when Mayor Bean calls him back into service as Commissioner of New York City Social Services. This was the time when New York City experienced the famous fiscal crisis. It hit puny pretty hard, too. And many state and national leaders around the country were hell-bent on undoing the New Deal. Conservatism was on the rise. Again, Dumpson was tasked with downsizing his own agency. He took the job in hopes of limiting the cuts. But in the end, the mounting hostility to public welfare was too much, even for Mr. Dumpson, Dr. Dumpson, now in his 70s. He left the service to consult with the New York Community Trust and to continue to fight for a better social welfare system, including child welfare services for persons of color. He remained a critic of the the policies that targeted poor women on welfare, the attack that he was upset about, and as was I and many other people, did end welfare as we know it. That was Bill Clinton's famous phrase. Because Congress stripped this program of its entitlement status and converted it into a block grant, which changed the story. It became a welfare reform became known as the racialized stalking horse of a revived effort to dismantle the program that helps poor women and receiving public assistance, as well as the attack on the entire welfare state. The attack may ebb and flow, but it continues to this day with some unfortunate successes. But I'm happy to say that New York City is undoing some of the worst features of welfare reform, like eliminating the infamous workforce program, which recently happened under Steve Banks. And during the same time, I'm going back to this conservative moment, the philosophy for child welfare shifted from rehabilitation of families to punishment. We did not know then that this attack on welfare, as I call it, that began in the 70s, was part of a major U-turn in public policy, a shift that was neither accidental or simply mean-spirited. Faced with a crisis of profitability, the leaders in business and government rejected the New Deal paradigm that for the preceding 40 years had called for redistributing income upwards and expanding the role of the state. And now they called for the hostility to big government led to the call for redistributing income upwards and downsizing the state. And that's the period we're in now. And Dumpson was around where this was going on, and he continued to be, he continued to fight this austerity regime, as well as all the isms that we're talking about, taking on a wide range of emerging issues, as have been mentioned, during his active career. One of his last messages to social workers was that to intensify our role in social action, we ignore his call today at our own peril.
Thank you, Mimi. I would just add to Mimi's remarks is that although for much of his career during those years, it was mostly conservative, and I think we would all agree that the ABC program, Programs for the Poor, have never had a lot of popularity in the United States or in the United States. But when he was pushing back against these programs, he really was not alienating people. He was doing the work. He was kind of pushing back and preserving programs in a way that really was not alienating people. When you think about on his watch that he had to implement unpopular programs like the man in the house rule, where welfare workers would go out in the middle of the night to check and see if there was any evidence of a man in the home so that the person was not eligible for public assistance. But he had to do that for many of the programs. He would comment that here he was, a Catholic, a social worker, and a minority, an African American, and he was able to move in a way to really implement in a very just way, in a very humane way, programs that were not very popular. And as Mimi referred to, the welfare rolls continued to kind of color up. And the more they colored up, the more hostility was directed towards the program as it moved from being a program that was initially established for a program for deserving women, which really meant white women who were not divorced, not having children out of wedlock. The program became more controversial. So he was always implementing that aid to dependent program at a very controversial time, but he was able to do it in a very humanistic, a very humane way. So I want to bring Mayor Dinkins in on this conversation. Mayor Dinkins, as Mimi also said, Dr. Dumpson served for five mayors, but he had key positions for maybe three mayors. He served as Commissioner of Welfare for Mayor Beam. Mayor Wagner was his first commissioner that he served for, and the second was Mayor Beam. And then Mayor Dinkins called him back into service to serve as president and chairman of the Health and Hospitals Corporation. Mayor Dinkins also called Dr. Dumpson in to work on his administration as Manhattan Borough President. And because we're kind of pressing for time now here, I just want to say very quickly that not only did Mayor Dinkins call in Dr. Dumpson to head his task force on homelessness, at that time, when Mayor Dinkins was president of the Manhattan president, social problems in New York City was on the rise. You had issues of HIV/AIDS, you had homelessness, things were just many, many social problems. Mayor Dinkins called him in, Dr. Dumpson in. Not only did he call Dr. Dumpson in, but he called in other social workers as well to have these key positions. So my question to you, Mayor Dinkins, is can you kind of elaborate on why you were willing to invest in programs that were very much oriented towards social work values, like the Beacon Schools, like Safe City, Safe Kids? You were willing to invest in programs that may have been costly in the short run, but was very much anchored in social work values. But can you comment on why you called Dr. Dumpson and gave so much, you invested so many social workers to head these programs?
Well, first of all, I'm delighted to be here. People say to me these days, now that you have changed occupation, you've retired, you must have a lot of time. And I explained, I didn't retire, I changed occupations, and that wasn't my idea. I got evicted from public housing. That's what Gracie Mansion is, you know. Public housing. But I've been very pleased of late where there has been acknowledgement of some of the good work that was done by our administration in the borough president's office and in the mayor's office. Dr. Billy Jones is sitting here, and he was part of his guys like Billy and Jim Dumpson that made me look smart. People thought I knew what the hell I was doing, because I had these smart people around me. Now, the AIDS epidemic hit, it was terrible, and black ministers were saying that's the way, God's way of punishing those people. That's what was said at the time. And I'm proud that I was not the first, Jim was the first, but I later was, for about 5 or 6 years, was chairman of the National Black Commission on AIDS, which was founded by Deborah Frazier House. And it's amazing. I can remember the day that they came in to me and they said, "Mr. Mayor, we want you to sign on the needle exchange." I said, wait a minute, what are you talking about? Needle exchange. We're going to give clean needles to drug addicts. I said, you must be kidding. I said, first of all, I'm not too big on methadone. And they said, sit down and listen. And I sat down and I listened. I had the good fortune of having a lot of brilliant, good, honest, hardworking women and men with me, and they explained to me how the AIDS was spreading because of the use of contaminated needles with drug addicts, and if you got the people, one, use clean needles, that would reduce the spread, and two, maybe only 1%, maybe 2% of those persons who were addicts would get off of drugs because of programs around this. And so we did, and we were very proud that we had done that. And you will remember that in 1990, they spoke about the crime rate, and it was always spoken of as though on December 31st, 1989, there was no crime. Just the next day when I became mayor. And so the headline said, "Dave, do something." And as you, this audience certainly knows, New York City does not have the power to tax itself without permission from Albany. So we designed a program called Safe Street, Safe City, subtitle Cops and Kids. And a long story on how we got that legislation through, because some white Queens senators, when we said, Milt Mollin and I said to them, you know, people are dying in the street. And they said, Mr. Mayor, our constituency is interested in auto theft and graffiti. I mean, it was that kind of bad. But anyway, we won. We got the legislation. And I'm surprised but proud of the fact that they still have Beacon schools. I figured that Rudy would do away with Beacon schools. But we still have Beacon schools to this day. And it was because of Barbara Sable and Richard Murphy and a whole lot of good people with Jim with that steadying hand helped us get things done. And so it was not profound. You said, well, you got the brakes. Why not use them during the beyond the hours of normal instruction? And that's all we did, except we had to provide money programs that the community designed for the to be run by, paid for by the city, but run by the community. And it worked. It worked very well. And but it's because of Jim Dumpson and Barbara Sable and Billy Jones and Richard Murphy and pardon me, a lot of really good, smart, caring people that we were able to get this done. I can remember, I'll just say this and I'll shut up for the moment. When I was, before I was Manhattan Borough President, I was the city clerk for 10 years. The city clerk runs the Marriage License Bureau. And the custom was if one were unable to come physically to the office of the city clerk, you'd send a letter saying that one of the applicants was ill and unable to attend. Then a clerk would go to the home or to the hospital or whatever to do it. And on this occasion, someone wrote and said that the prospective groom, I think it was terminally ill with AIDS. They hadn't said with AIDS, it would have been fine. They're terminally ill with AIDS. So nobody wanted to go. So I went. And everybody's wearing masks in the hospital room. The masks weren't to protect us, damn it, it was to protect the patient. But thereafter, we had no problems. So people, whenever we had such a problem, people would come, our clerks would go. And we had clerks in five boroughs. I had deputies in one in each borough. And so we knew early on about AIDS. And when Deborah Fraser Howes and others said to me, Dave, listen. And I listened. And of course, they were right. And but Jim Dumpson is an example of the kind of public servant that we so desperately need in not just this city, but throughout the nation. Smart, committed, caring, honest. You just don't come upon people like that every day. And I had the good fortune of having people like that work with me so that folks thought I was smart. I didn't know much, but I had smart people.
Well, actually, the last chapter of the book really focuses a lot on your administration, Mayor Dinkins. And I'm going to stick with you and ask my second question of you. that when Dr. Dumpson served as Commissioner of Welfare for Mayor Wagner's administration, probably the most challenging event he faced was a welfare rights movement and the sit-ins that sort of shut down all the welfare offices, and also the strike of public welfare workers. And when you read the papers in that area, they really are fascinating. And all of that is described in the book as well, where you see some of the personal letters that come from people like clients who were commending him for the work that he was doing in that area, from Daniel Patrick Moynihan that commended him for advocating for a guaranteed wage. I think probably the biggest challenge that he faced when he was serving as commissioner for the Beam administration was, as Mimi said, the city was on the brink of financial bankruptcy. And of course you knew the services that were gonna get cut first would be services for the poor. And I think that as people were sort of amazed that he was going back into government service at this point. And the reason he went back, you alluded to that, Mimi, the reason he went back is that he thought he could hold off those severe cuts that were going to be aiming against the programs for the poor. I think for your administration that, and I would think one of the biggest challenges that you face, and if you haven't read Mayor Dinkins' book, A Mayor's Life, you really should read it. Much of what's in this book sort of dovetails in what's in the mayor's book. But I would say that one of the most challenging situations that you faced would have been those Crown Hunts riots. Now, I don't want to talk about that, but I do want to ask you this question, that those riots, they surfaced a lot of things, but they also surfaced that ongoing controversy about whether or not to privatize the Health and Hospitals Corporation, and Dr. Jones is here now. But I'd like to read you this and ask you what you think about this. Dr. Dumpson had to prepare a report as to the young rabbinical student who died while he was being cared for at Kings County. And there was a whole push, and that push comes up every now and then about whether or not to privatize the Health and Hospitals Corporations. I just want to read this from Dr. Dumpson's report that he wrote for you and see what you think have to say about this now. He says, many argue that this is a way to cure whatever ails a corporation. For many reasons, I'm talking about privatization. For many reasons, I believe that this is not a wise idea. HHC's mission continues to be providing health care to all New Yorkers, regardless of their economic status. If some of HHC's hospitals were privatized, this goal would not be properly met. Let me explain to you the magnitude of our task. With 20% of the city's beds, HHC provides care for 50% of New Yorkers seeking outpatient care. 35%, and this is in 1991, remember, 35% of all AIDS patients, 50% of all psychiatric patients, and a large majority of New York's uninsured, including the poor, homeless, and undocumented immigrants. If privately owned and managed, there is no guarantee that all of these New Yorkers would have access to care. So my question to you is, as you reflect on, now, how would you feel about, what are your thoughts about HHC maintaining being a municipal hospital system? What are your thoughts about privatization now?
No, it hadn't changed.
Hasn't changed.
No, makes a lot of sense. I remember when Mike Holloman became head of the Health and Hospitals Corporation, and I'll never forget, he said, I'm going to make Harlem Hospital the flagship of the fleet, and Harlem's doing not bad these days. I think Jim was right then and right now.
Right today, okay.
Yeah, I don't know. I suppose part of our problem is some of us get nervous and excited and agitated only in times of woe. whereas we really ought to be concerned all of the time and paying attention all of the time and listen to people. And unfortunately, there's not too many people like Jim Dumpson, but people like that you need to listen to because they really care about the rest of us.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to ask two quick questions, and I'm going to direct these to both to Pat and to Mimi very quickly. Dr. Dumpson was concerned about, he always believed in the public mission of social work. I know that many people here are not social workers, but he was always concerned about the public mission of social work, and he believed that social work had a major role to play in creating what he referred to as this caring society. And that was a society that cared about all members of his society, was committed to create the kind of society that dealt equally with all members of society, regardless of their station in life. So in a later part of his career, when he gave his one of his last speeches at the APM of the Council on Social Work Education, he was concerned that social work was moving away from that mission, that we were sort of breaking up into micro and macro practice, and that many social workers were more invested in doing micro practice, where they were kind of helping the individual as opposed to being involved in large-scale cause practices, and also moving away from government service and public service, which was always dear to him. So I'm going to ask you that question. The other question to you, I'm going to direct to Pat, is that he was strong on mentoring. Mentoring is a section in the book on mentoring. He not only mentored young professionals, because he was very committed to creating a strong, skilled, and competent workforce, but he also mentored older professionals, experienced professionals, when they were entering and taking on new and difficult assignments. We talked a lot about Dr. being a humanitarian, which he was. He was also a political being, and he was able to move. He knew how to negotiate in both academia, which sometimes people don't think has political ramifications, but it does, and he wrote a paper in his collection is a paper called Reflections on the Deanship, where he talks about the politics. He compares the politics in government and the politics in academia. But Pat, you were mentored by him, so if you can reflect on your experience with him as a mentor and mentoring not only new professionals but experienced professionals. And Mimi, if you could reflect on, because you're on the faculty of the public school social work, if you can reflect on our social workers moving away from our historic mission and commitment to social justice, concern for the oppressed and the poor, and practice as a public servant. Oh, let me tell the story about mentoring about Dr. Dumpson, which I also love. Dr. Dumpson, as a high school student, his teacher asked him, do you know who was his mentor? We asked him, do you know who Alan Locke is? That Mayor Dinkins knows who Alan Locke is, yeah. And so he didn't know, but he was a good student, so he went to find out who he was. And when he did his research, he found that Alan Locke was the first African-American Rhodes Scholar, and he was also the father of the Harlem Renaissance. And so Dr. Dumpson says in his papers, it was an oral history interview, he says in the interview that it was the first time it sort of turned him on to being interested in his own ethnic heritage, and it really tied him into the importance of mentoring. So our time is moving on, so we could do it kind of quickly.
So I think this is a part of Dr. Dumpson that I absolutely love to talk about. And that is my relationship with him as one of his mentees. As I look around this room, the question that I would ask is, how many of you claim Dr. Dumpson as your mentor? Just a show of hand, okay? What that should say to all of us is that we belong to a very prestigious club. Now, I go a step further to say that I was the last of his mentees. I was the problem child of the mentee club. I met Dr. Dumpson in January of 1987. And similar to the story that Alma told about Dr. Dumpson having been asked if he knew someone, when I announced that I was going to go work at the Trust, my former boss asked me, did I know Dr. Dumpson? And of course, I said no. And she said, well, he is someone that you need to know. And so my first day at the Trust, I made a beeline to his office to meet the famous Dr. Dumpson. And she was right. He was clearly someone that I needed to know and enjoyed knowing. I don't ever believe that in a mentoring relationship that I asked him to be my mentor. I just kept showing up in his office and then in his home. I knew that I wanted him in my life, and I later came to realize that we mattered to each other. One of the benefits of being mentored by someone who was physically in the workplace with me is that it gave him an opportunity to see me at work. And so his critique was firsthand, and they were timely. And that's a mentoring model that I would highly recommend to others. It also meant that he played many roles in my regards, both inside and outside the foundation. He was often a messenger, an interpreter, and a broker, particularly in situations when I had done something that ruffled somebody's feather. Dr. Dumpson would often say to me in those situations, do nothing until I get back to you. And that was clearly the sign that, sit still, you've done enough damage. Two pearls of wisdom that I take from my time with Dr. Dumpson was his constant message to me of pick your battles. Not every battle is yours. And in fact, one would say that there are certainly enough of us around to carry on some of the other charges, but pick your battle. The other was this notion of being true to your belief. He would say, live a life of purpose and meaning. And as someone in philanthropy of color, we would often show up at meetings in which we were the only person of color in the room. And here again, Dr. Dumpson would say, make your presence in the room matter. You have something to contribute to the conversation, but make certain that that contribution ties into your belief and your values. And so I approached my soiree into the world, having been taught by the master, and that is Dr. Dumpson. I remember on what turned out to be Dr. Dumpson's last day at the Trust, he called me from his office and he told me that his work was done and that he was going home to rest. In reality, what he was doing was moving his office from the 22nd floor of 909 Third Avenue to his apartment on Fifth Avenue. And it was from there that he continued to hold court and where I and others continued to seek his counsel. It's, I think as a sort of a final point about Dr. Dumpson, he loved the profession of social work. And one of the things that he expected of all of his mentors, particularly those of us who were social workers, was that we share that love for the field. And I'd like to think that the work that I'm doing now through the Fund for Social Policy Education Practice comes out of the recognition that as social workers, we are to do all that we can to continue to lift the field up and its importance as a change agent. Dr. Dumpson was not a radical. He was radical in his ideology and in his innovation. But as someone who sat at his knees and had frequent conversations with him, the radical posture became the commitment to change. And as long as we, I think, hold on to that thought, it is clear to me and hopefully to many of you in the room that our field, the field of social work, has much to do, and he still is expecting us to be true to that concept and
Excellent.
To that commitment.
Well, based on what Pat said, we really haven't lost our commitment to our historic mission. Would you like to just say a few words, Mimi?
Just a few words. First, when I was reading your book, Alma, I started to think Dumpson would have really loved Bernie Sanders. Right? I mean, you know, different time, but, and Bernie Sanders would have loved James R. Dumpson. They both would have loved each other's ideas. Dumpson placed a high premium on human rights and social justice, but he faced these constraints as a public official, as we all talked about, in periods that rejected his worldview. But so many times he ended up governing more like Hillary Clinton or Barack Obama than Bernie Sanders. I just, you know, he just could have felt, and that's a little bit what you were saying, I think, also. I'm not going to go over his idea. I was going to talk about two things, his role of the government and role of social work, but the role of the government, I think, has been quite clear. He saw the role of the government as essential to addressing social problems and that we all should be committed to making sure that it survived. And as for social work, he saw social work as an anchor profession in social welfare, and he believed our role was essential to promote to advance social justice. We had to promote causes that recognized the interests of the individual and those of the collective society were one and the same. He opposed blaming the victim. He viewed work, as Alma said, work with individuals and changing social structures as really linked to each other. And he said that you can't help people or understand them without recognizing how social structures either support or erect barriers to their full development. His commitment to social justice has not gone unchallenged, but he welcomed the challenge. Some people think that when social workers make individual and social change a fundamental part of social work practice, they politicize a previously neutral profession, neutral and objective. Yet Dumpson's work and his thinking demonstrate that social work has always been political in that it either deals with human consciousness or the allocation of resources. Arguing for neutrality of professional practice or public policy represents a political stance of its own, one that favors the status quo by letting it go unchallenged. So Dumpson understood that because social workers cannot avoid the political, it's far better to address these issues explicitly than to pretend that they do not exist. One can even say that such a stance offers a more ethical option than practicing non-political social work. As we look around today, we can see that the middle ground, if one ever existed, quickly recedes. Social workers must decide, and all of us in this room must decide, on which side we stand. And I think that reflects Dumpson's work and thinking.
And it sort of speaks to, and I'm not going to add, it speaks to the last chapter of this book that was written by the aftermath that was written by Dr. Dumpson's close colleague, Ed Mullen. And Ed Mullen asked us to consider how far have we come over the 60-year period, half century of Dr. Dumpson's career of achieving what he called this caring society. And Ed lays out certain areas like child welfare, mental health, services to the aging, income inequalities, and I think that we can answer that ourselves. Before I open it up for question and answers, I would just to ask Jeree, Dr. Dumpson's beloved daughter, if she would like to say a few words about her dad. Oh, okay.
Okay, so the two things I want to say. I had sisters. I remember being at the house on one of the surprise birthday parties. And I remember you sitting on the floor, Pat. You were there, Alma, and Megan was there. And I just felt he had such love for you and many others, but you three particularly. He really loved you. And I felt, I'm not an only child here, you know. I'm not. I have sisters. And you helped me through the latter years of his life with so much compassion and so much love for him and so much care for me. So I just want to thank you for that. My father had a village. Part of my village is here tonight, Billy and Lewis. And Ed Mullen, who took me to my first opera. And just a village that of people, along with my mother, who would trudge, I don't know whether you made it to the, you didn't miss anything, to my first 5 or 6 years of dancing school. And they would come and watch me perform, but they had to wait for everybody else to perform because I was only in 3 numbers. And so they would come on the weekend, for the whole weekend, and watch me do practice. As my mother would say, it was a waste of money. But they came. And they came because if it had been up to my mother, I wouldn't have been taking dance lessons. But my father really said that was okay, and I could be a singer if I wanted to. I've told some of you this before, but not a dumb singer. And I could do anything I wanted to do as long as I was kind. That's the only thing he asked of me. He didn't ask for anything else. Just be myself, treat others the way you want to be treated. And they didn't, she too, they didn't ask much of me. And they were very wonderful people. They were very busy people, my mother and father. And they were very much alike. They just worked. She, the same, in service to Harlem Hospital, School of Anesthesia. She, the same, in service. She was the first African-American to become president of the American Association of Nurse Anesthetists. And when she moved here in May, with great protests from her, from Hawaii. I don't understand. Hawaii, New Jersey, what's the difference? But when she moved here in May, after really having a hard, you know, illness and everything, and agreed to come and live with me, we got so many letters from so many nurse anesthetists all over the country that she didn't even know, because they put it on their Facebook page. She didn't have a Facebook page. I don't even have a Facebook page. Daddy didn't have a Facebook page. But she and my father were such great parents. My dad, there are many moments I can remember, but the three most important moments were when I was very young. I went to church with him and her, but mostly with him, because sometimes she was sleepy. Sorry. Anyway, and I was little. I was 5, you know, or so. And I remember we had a Chevrolet. We lived at 730 Riverside Drive. And we had a Chevrolet, and he would take me, and I'd have a cute little dress and everything, and he'd put his hand in mine, and what I remember, and you know, my father wasn't a tall or big man, but to a 5-year-old, I remember my little hand in his, and he'd keep his hand in mine all day long, because after church, we went to visit people, and then we went and had lunch, and finally we would get home. And so I grew up always, if I were scared, remembering my hand in my father's. And I would call him and say, this is what's bothering me, or I'd write him, or this is, you know, and if I was away and traveling. And so he was always there. He was a good father to us, and he loved you girls. He really, really, truly did. I myself never wanted to be a social worker. Way too much work, you guys. Oh my goodness. But that was the first one. The second one that meant so much, there were so many, but these are the three I'll tell you about, is that he trusted me enough to take care of him when he was older. That was such an honor, to take care of my father. It was fun. He was funny. He would say the craziest things. So we were walking down the hall in that very same wheelchair. We were walking down the hall, and at 1270 Fifth Avenue, your second home, and he said, oh, and this was when he was in his late 90s, I'm ready to go to glory, because that's what he called it, glory. I am so ready to go. I said, you cannot go. You can't leave me. I don't want to be here by myself. He said, you can go. He literally said, you can go. Elevator came, elevator went, and we were, I said, well, no, I'm not ready to go. So he said, well, if you want to go, you can go, but when I'm ready to go, I'm going. And that was the story about glory. And then the last thing is the conversation between my dear mother and my father, because she couldn't get here. She was very ill for the funeral, and it was the day before he died, and it was just the sweetest conversation. I couldn't hear what she was saying, but I could hear what he was saying, which was just enough for me to hear, to know that these two people, although they decide, you know, some people can't live in the same city, state. Anyway, so, but they, in his latter years, he spent much time with Mommy and I in Hawaii, so it was really, really wonderful. So that was the third thing, that conversation. And lastly, going through his papers and going through his letters and his books and just amazing things. He had written a diary about his time in Pakistan, and he talked about the women and how they were treated. And this was 1950, I believe. Right? Okay. And, I mean, eloquently he talked about them and with compassion and pain. And he just wrote and wrote and wrote and just looking at the pictures of him with other people. I mean, who has pictures of everybody? You know, it's amazing. So all I can say is thank you for coming. Thank Alma for writing the book. Thank Mommy for moving here. And thank God James Dumpson was my father.
I think we have time for one question, maybe two questions, short questions.
I have to address this to Mayor Dinkins, and it would be amazing if you remember this, Mayor, but sometimes goodness that people do, little things live on and on. You were visiting the junior high school where I taught, 129th Street and Amsterdam Avenue. You were walking through the hall. The teachers were in the hallway. You were with an entourage, and I wanted to speak with you, and the Secret Service pulled you away. You sort of put them aside. You came to my door. I said, Mayor, it's my husband's birthday. Will you sign the card? And you stood there and you said, tell me what you want me to say. And you took your time and you wrote it. And it made my husband so happy because he didn't live much past that day. But thank you, Mayor Dinkins. I've repeated this many times.
Then we'll go for our reception. So I have to confess, I am not C. Virginia Fields, although she is my boss, and it's a privilege to be on the program management team at the National Black Leadership Commission on AIDS. So thank you for your remarks about the organization and the history it has and the great work. It's a privilege for me as a social worker to be a part of now. I guess ask a question because you posed an interesting one. I finished social work school 4 years ago about micro and macro practice and this crisis I feel as being a recent graduate exists, which is the identity of social work and what role do social workers play in social justice. And I guess if you could answer a question for younger social workers who feel that this is an important movement and this is why my mother was one too. So working for Ms. Fields and having mentors like them to be guiding my path, what would you feel is the message in the classroom in an educational place for people to feel that social justice mission should be restored and that micro practice is part of it? guess is my question.
Well, you picked a topic close to my heart. I teach public policy, so those micro means practice with individuals, macro means sort of more structural kind of things, in case some people don't use our language. Right now in social work, there's a tremendous concern among many people that there are less than 10% of the students are enrolled in either macro practice, which includes community organizing and administration. So the rest of the students are clinical, and they do terrific, terrific work. That's not the point, but there seems to be an imbalance that many in the nationally. And so a campaign has been started. Maybe you know about it, called Macro Matters. And there's a special commission on macro practice, and it's working very hard, very carefully, and very effectively within the profession to raise just the issue that you are raising. And so one has to do with macro practice. I think Pat's involved with a fund now that's trying to lift, making sure that all social workers, whether they're macro or micro, are policy informed. One of the problems is that there's not enough time in the curriculum to get to everything, and so very often our students who are learning individual work don't get to really get a chance to make the connections enough that it sticks with them. So there are two very big efforts underway now that would make you very happy, because they're moving exactly in the direction that you're asking for.
I know that we want to go for the reception, but I just want to say this one thing. My student is here. He's an international student from China, and he's very much into social reform. And I think the short answer to your question is that we teach social justice by the way we present ourselves to our students in the classroom. And I would hope that if I had an opportunity for Chief Kong to respond, that he would say that Dr. Carten, by her very presence, by her very message, that she is teaching a very strong message of social justice. So we are way over time, and thank you all very much.